Right now on a special edition of KCCI 8 News Close-Up, it has been a big political weekend here in Iowa. 17 candidates made their pitches to caucus-goers yesterday at the annual Polk County Democratic Party steak fry with record-breaking attendance. This morning, we take a look at which candidates stood out at that big event and who is still struggling to gain traction here in Iowa. KCCI 8 News Close-Up starts right now.
This is Iowa's news leader. This is KCCI 8 News Close Up.
Good Sunday morning, everybody, and thank you very much for joining us on Close Up. Senator Elizabeth Warren is now leading the polls here in Iowa. The Des Moines Register released its new Iowa poll last night on presidential preference. It shows Warren has 22% among likely Democratic Party caucus goers, followed by former Vice President Joe Biden, Senator Bernie Sanders, Mayor Pete Buttigieg, Senator Kamala Harris, Senator Cory Booker, and Senator Amy Klobuchar. Just hours before the poll was released, 17 presidential candidates took the stage at Des Moines Waterworks Park for the annual Polk County Democratic Party steak fry. And as KCCI's Chris Gottner shows us, the campaigns really pulled out all the stops.
It's political pageantry on full display.
Oh, this is all right.
It's candidates flipping and grilling all kinds of meat, or even meatless burgers for noted vegan Cory Booker.
Vegan burgers, taste good?
Oh my gosh.
Even I tried one.
We were surprised. We've done, I bet, 500-600 of these. I think that's a pretty good amount for Iowans who are generally, you know, steak eaters.
Shaking hands, taking selfies on Saturday, the Polk Democrat steak fry was perhaps the center of the political universe.
I want to hear what people have to say. And it's all in one place and we get to eat.
And it might be best described as controlled chaos. 17 Democratic presidential candidates, it's a chance to reach the more than 12,000 potential caucus goers who attended. That's a record.
This is my first steak fry, so I'm happy to be here. Look forward to spending the day here.
Iowans take this seriously, and we know that there's about 135 days before anybody actually expresses their preference, so there's a lot of good work to be doing here.
Rain couldn't douse the campaigning, and it didn't dampen the enthusiasm of fired-up Democrats.
It's all the enthusiasm of everybody, and to see the different camps set up, it's just a lot of fun.
At Waterworks Park in Des Moines, Chris Gottner, KCCI 8 News, Iowa's news leader.
Joining us now to talk about this busy weekend is KCCI political analyst Dennis Goldford. You were at the steak fry yesterday, Dennis. 17 of those presidential candidates on stage. According to the Des Moines Register's latest poll, Senator Warren, former Vice President Joe Biden, and Senator Sanders remain the top three. Let's start right there. Did Warren capture the crowd at the steak fry?
Well, you know, the caucuses are ultimately about organization and enthusiasm, and events like these, which are so Iowan, they don't get to do this in any other state, give the campaigns a chance to try this out and get themselves organized and work with that enthusiasm. And so I was struck particularly by the Warren campaign. They certainly had their people out. Everybody had people out, but the Warren campaign had a lot of people, a lot of signs all over the place, very good response to her. I think that Buttigieg also had a good amount of enthusiasm and organization there as well.
Okay, Joe Biden, has he already hit his peak, do you think? He's dropped back in this latest poll.
Well, you know, we're not sure how much we'll be going up and down a kind of hilly section of the road for him, but he certainly didn't seem to resonate very well at the steak fry. He went on, he may have been reading his material and just went on and on and on, and the music finally had to play him off, and there were times he just got his words garbled together, so it was hard to understand him. So he's always been a soft front runner, and this latest poll shows that.
Okay, Senator Sanders, at this point in the 26 campaign, he was the ascendant guy. Is he in that same spot now, or maybe has his message become a little stale?
Well, if you paid attention to Senator Sanders in 2016, you've already seen the movie. He does the same thing, talks about the same issues now with maybe some slight alterations. And again, in terms of the response to him at the steak fry, the audience, the participants were respectful, but again, he didn't get an overwhelming response either, not the sort of response he got 4 years ago.
Okay, what about Kamala Harris? She seems to have gone all in on the state of Iowa, has really improved her organization here. Do you see a pathway toward winning Iowa and potentially being able to climb from there?
Well, we always have to bear in mind we still have several months to go. I mean, in 2012, 2 weeks before the caucuses, which Mitt Romney won, Rick Santorum was in the low single digits and roared into a virtual tie for first place with him, even though he couldn't sustain that later. So we're a long way out. The question for these candidates is whether they'll still get enough in the way of campaign donations, the money to keep them going, or whether they will in fact feel they have to drop out because they just can't support their staff.
Okay, you mentioned Pete Buttigieg. He received some loud applause yesterday for some of the lines in his speech. Can you believe that a mayor of South Bend, Indiana can do as well as he's doing?
Well, it's an unusual year, and we're testing out all sorts of possibilities we really hadn't thought of before. I mean, he's, what, 37 years old? That's extremely young. And the Democratic Party now has this, I won't say rift, but has this somewhat of a division between the older generation who tend to be more comfortable with, if not enthusiastic about, Vice President Biden, and the younger folks who are looking for somebody with a different kind of message. They supported Bernie Sanders last time around, even though he's that same older generation. But there are a lot of people claiming the allegiance of that younger generation now. The key question for Democrats is, when for all sorts of these people, when their candidate does not win the caucuses and win the nomination, will they show up to vote for them in November of 2020?
Okay, what about Senator Cory Booker? Politico is reporting that his campaign may be flagging, showing signs of trouble. What have you heard there?
Pretty much that. I mean, we have to remember the campaign is like a race car, and if there's no fuel for the race car, it's got to get off the track. It can't go anywhere. And Booker seems to be saying that's where they are at this point.
Okay, Dennis, thank you very much. We will continue our conversation with our political analyst, Dennis Goldberg, here next on KCCI News Close Up. Stay with us. Welcome back on this rainy Sunday morning to KCCI News Close Up. We're continuing our conversation with KCCI political analyst Dennis Goldford. And Dennis, let's take a look at some of the lesser polling, the bottom polling candidates in the Des Moines Register poll. Polling at 2%, Congressman Tulsi Gabbard, former Representative Beto O'Rourke, and businessmen Tom Steyer and Andrew Yang. At this point in the caucus process, Dennis, can any of these people really kind of put it together and get going?
They have an uphill battle, but you have to remember, you know, we've, on the one hand, been at this for well over a year. I mean, John Delaney, who was not at the steak fry, has been out for in Iowa all over the place for well over a year. So we feel this has been going on for a long time. But really, technically speaking, there's a lot of time left in the caucus process. Again, we're only in mid-September, and we've got until February 3rd. Now, that being said, these folks have to start to catch fire at some point. They've got to show some potential, or as we've noted, the campaign funding will dry up.
Okay, another person who needs to catch fire is Montana Governor Steve Bullock. He has support of Iowa Attorney General Tom Miller, a Democratic Party heavyweight here. But Bullock is barely registering in the polls. That means he can't qualify for the debates. And our Chris Gothner talked with Bullock about that issue. Here is the governor's response.
The governor's still trying to get into the debate, still trying to get some traction in the polls. Do you see a path forward right now on your campaign?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, look, is he the only governor in this race anymore? You're seeing more and more people drop out. Is he the only one that won a Trump state? Now we got to win back places that we lost. And what I see is folks really taking this seriously. And every other time, the Iowa caucuses, folks wait to decide who they're going to caucus for till near the end.
Dennis, he's a moderate. He's a governor. He has a good track record electorally. Why can't he get it together?
Well, you know, there's always a matter of doing everything you can organizationally and strategically, and you plan a campaign. There's still an element of lightning has to strike. Mm-hmm. And yes, a lot of people I talked to at the state fair liked Bullock, but were they ready to make him their number one choice? No, not at all yet. There were several people I talked to, older people, who weren't comfortable with the thought of Medicare for all and the sorts of things that the leading candidates were talking about. If Vice President Biden seems to fade, and the more moderate candidates want someplace else to go before we finally have the caucus result, if Bullock remains in, maybe they'd go with him. But so far, this has not been a governor's year. It's been more of a senator's year.
Okay, well, Governor Reynolds, she held her own event right this weekend out at the state fairgrounds. She did have much of the Iowa Republican delegation there. Second Lady Karen Pence, was she just trying to deflect attention from the steak fry? What was she doing?
Well, I think that certainly you want to rally the troops. We had, estimates of about 500 or so people who were there as opposed to 12,000 who were at the steak fry, but she brought out Karen Pence and basically laid out the basic Republican message about what's important is faith, family, freedom. And the interesting line I found was the claim that these Democrats want to take your money and give it to somebody else. That may be an emerging theme among the Republicans for this fall.
All right. Well, Dennis, thank you very much, as always, for your expertise. I certainly appreciate it. And up next on our political panel here on Close Up, we have Democratic strategist Jeff Blink and Republican strategist Eric Wolson. A couple of good guys. We'll be right back.
The rising cost of living is making
Welcome back to Close Up, everybody. It's a good place to be on a rainy Sunday morning talking Iowa politics. Joining me now to talk about the very busy political weekend here are Democratic strategist Jeff Link and Republican strategist Eric Wilson. And Jeff, yesterday at the steak fry, who stood out to you? Who do you think did really well?
Well, I think, first of all, the Polk County Democrats should get credit for organizing a really terrific event. We dodged the big rainstorm throughout most of the day, so you got to start there. Everything seemed to go pretty well, and that's hard with 12,000 people in Waterworks Park. Mm-hmm. But I agree with what Dennis Goldford said. Elizabeth Warren had a really good day. Mayor Pete Buttigieg also had a really good day, and was a little surprising that he had such a good showing organizationally, because they were kind of later to staff up, and of course now they've got more than 100 staff people in the state, and you could kind of tell yesterday. Mm-hmm. I thought Vice President Biden did a solid job, but you know, there's just not the same amount of energy with his supporters as there are with some of the others.
Okay, what do you think of his slip in the polls? He is now 2 points behind Elizabeth Warren.
Well, in a lot of ways, this could be the best news possible for Joe Biden. It is very difficult to lead a race from tip to tail, and he has been in the lead for a long time. This will change the expectations game. I think where we were before this Iowa poll, it was Biden's to lose. If Warren holds this lead for a while and she doesn't happen to win the caucuses, people are going to say, what happened? Whereas if she'd been in second all the way through and comes up with a surprise victory, expectations get really important towards the end.
Yeah, Eric, I see you nodding your head over there.
You bet. Well, two great points from Jeff. First, of course, anybody that's ever organized 12-person cookout knows how tough that is. And so my hat's off, too, to the folks that organized that event. Very impressive event. But, you know, I was with Governor Huckabee in 2008, and we started out in eighth place. And by November, we were in first place. All along, I said, look, we got to finish in the top three. Well, by November, the press expectations were, if you don't win this race, you're finished. And I'm like, wait a minute, you know, we were in eighth place and here we are, you know, in the top three. So that expectations game that Jeff talks about is very important. I think what happens after a change in the polls like this too is you start to see a change in that energy that Jeff talked about too. The staff has a greater sense of urgency. We're not the front runner anymore. We have to up our game a little bit. So I think it's going to get really interesting as we come down the home stretch.
Okay, Jeff, Senator Sanders almost won in 2016. Things appear to be different here in 2020, and the polls kind of bearing that out.
Well, the biggest difference is he's not in a two-person race, and Secretary Clinton was a very popular figure, but a very polarizing figure, even among Democrats. And so I think about half of Senator Sanders' support in 2016 were people just enthusiastic about his message and embracing political revolution, and about half of his support were people that didn't want to support Secretary Clinton. Now with the 20-person race, and with Senator Warren and others who have kind of embraced his policy positions and ideas, they have alternatives. And that's a challenge for the Sanders campaign.
Okay. And I'd go back to that historical analogy on the Republican side also. Mike Huckabee gets 34% in 2008. He runs in 2016 and gets 1.8%. You know, Rick Santorum wins a little, 2012, he wins. And then in 2016, he ends up with 1%. You know, so I think there's maybe this sense too, as Jeff said, there's alternatives now, a lot more alternatives. But sort of, you had your chance 4 years ago, and let's look for somebody new now. Could be a big part of that equation.
Okay, speaking of that, messages have been honed. All of these people have been around the state a bunch. Is there anybody you, as a Republican operative, see as a real challenge to the Republican nominee, be it President Trump or whomever?
Yeah, I think it's so early in the process to try to figure that out. We're still in the regular season. We haven't gotten to the playoffs yet. Messages will continue to change. They'll continue to get sharper. And I think, you know, candidates in a broad primary tend to take the best elements of everybody. I don't know how many times I've had a candidate who's gets ready to go give a speech, and the guy ahead of him or the woman ahead of him takes his best lines because they know they're good applause lines. So I think we're going to see those candidates really kind of pick up on a message that has a lot of broad support among Democrats, independents, some maybe left-leaning Republicans, and figure that out as the process goes on.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen. We're not done with you yet, though. Stay right here. We'll wrap up our conversation with Jeff Link and Eric Wilson right after this break. You stay here, too.
Up for anything?
Welcome back to KCCI News Close-Up. We're wrapping up our conversation with Democratic strategist Jeff Link and Republican strategist Eric Wilson. Now, while at the steak fry, former Vice President Joe Biden called for an investigation into President Trump. Here's what he had to say.
Trump deserves to be investigated. He is violating every basic norm of a president. Trump's doing this because he knows I'll beat him like a drum, and he's using the abuse of power and every element of the presidency to try to do something to smear me.
That has to do with that phone call with the Ukrainian president. And Jeff, what do you think of what the vice president had to say there, former vice president?
Well, I think it's a strong statement. I think he purposefully wanted to have a strong statement on this. If Trump actually did what has been reported on that phone call, it's incredibly troubling to invite a foreign country to get involved in our election to try and bring a smear on a potential opponent. It's beyond the pale. It's probably an impeachable offense, even though I'm not pro-impeachment. So I think it's important for Biden to stand up and push back on this, because you cannot look weak in a situation like this, and I think it's important for him to do that.
Okay, but this is an issue, Eric, that the former vice president does not want brought up, really, because his son, Hunter, was a member of a board for a Ukrainian gas company, and people have been talking about this for years.
Yeah, and every president, I think, has a family member that is troublesome in one way or another. I think in this case, I have been looking at it more from the political sense that, as Jeff said, the vice president, the former vice president, needs to really kind of stand up and make a strong message, have a strong message. But I think one of the things that does too is sort of sets him up as the candidate that the president is most afraid of. And so from a political sense, there is that tightrope that you have to walk with Hunter on one side and the president on the other side. But I think if it's played right, it could be a good issue for him.
Okay.
Well, and The president really doesn't want to talk about Ukraine either because, of course, his campaign chair, Paul Manafort, was heavily involved in elections there, was involved with the corrupt president who was kicked out of the country, and, of course, is now in jail over some of those activities. So this is a sticky wicket for the president as well.
Okay. Let's get back to the polling, the steak fry, and stuff like that. Middle of the pack right now, according to the poll, Buttigieg, Harris, Booker, and Klobuchar. Jeff, any of them? Do any of them have the potential to surge here in the coming weeks?
Yes, I absolutely think so. We have 5 months to go. We're in the middle of a really important period that started yesterday with the steak fry. Mm-hmm. And I think that this six-week period that will end with the Democrats' fall gala on November 1st is going to be a very important period. We're going to have fundraising numbers released. We're going to see who's going to be able to tweak their message, mm-hmm. tweak their organization for that fall dinner. And I think Buttigieg showed signs yesterday of organizational strength, and that will carry, I think, into that November dinner. And it'll be interesting to see if Booker raises his 1.7 million. Klobuchar, in a poll that I've done for Focus on Rural America, had a little more strength than she's shown in the Iowa poll, but she's a neighbor. She's done well in the debates, and I think she could grow. And again, if Biden slips, there's room for these candidates. But if he maintains his position, it's just hard because there's so many candidates in this field.
Well, and I'll tell you who's not in the middle, and that would be the former congressman from Texas, Beto O'Rourke. I mean, I think what we've seen there is Democrats have kind of given him a once-over. They've taken a look at him, and they've seen there's less there than meets the eye.
Okay, Eric, I'll start with you on this one. What do you think will be the biggest issue in 2020? Everybody always talks about the economy and presidential elections, but there's so much going on.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah, I do think the economy is still going to be the biggest issue. It tends to be in most elections because, you know, you care about yourself and your family. You know, do I have a secure job? Is the economy chugging along where I know that I'm going to be able to make a decent living for my family? So I still think that's top of the list.
Jeff, you agree?
I do, and I think particularly here what happens with the ag economy, because obviously we've got a trade war going on, the Chinese market has been shut off, the president's choosing oil companies over ethanol producers, and that's squeezing farmers right now. And because they've had equity in their farms due to rising land prices, they've been able to weather this storm. Mm-hmm. But in another year or so, operating notes could be cut off, and it could be a huge problem for Trump.
Quickly, could it be as bad as the 1980s here in Iowa?
I don't know if it's bad as the 1980s. We keep hearing how they're not as leveraged. Farmers are not as leveraged as they have been in the past. But, you know, things can turn in a big hurry. And, you know, we've got to get that trade war figured out with the Chinese so that farmers start to make money again.
Okay. Thank you, Eric. Thank you, Jeff. No matter what happens, we'll have it right here on KCCI News Close-Up every Sunday. Have a good weekend.